conventional tubes. So conventional tubes are like you have the triode, tetrodes, and pentrodes. So before inventing these klystron tubes, so you have the triode conventional tubes to generate the microwave signal. So now what are the limitations of conventional tubes are? So microwave frequency. So that is a so we have the these are the limitations for the inter-electrode capacitance, lead inductance, transit time effect. So gain bandwidth product limitation. So we have the power losses. So that already we explained in the last class. So this is the inter-electrode capacitance. So where the capacitance, so reactance or capacitance is inversely proportional to the frequency. If more frequency, so reactance is very less. So here see the inter-electrode capacitance between the terminals of the triode may be short circuit. So and the lead inductance, so here, so it may provide the high impedance, so between input and the terminals of the triode. So because the reactance of the inductor is directly proportional to the frequency. So then coming to the transit time effect. So in transit time effect, so low frequencies, so less than 1 gigahertz, so there is no problem with this transit time for the triode. So if more frequencies, for high frequencies, for high frequencies means, so the time period of the signal is very less. So frequency is more means, so time period is very less. So now compared to the time period of signal frequency, the signal time period with the transit time, so there is a problem. So now, so at high frequencies, so here the cathode and grid changes with 10 to 100 times during the electron transit time. So here the electrons may oscillate back and forth in the cathode grid space or return to the cathode. So to minimize this, so this distance between the electrodes is to be reduced and high voltage must be applied, but this will increase the inter-electrode capacitance. It increases the inter-electrode capacitance. Okay. So then, so we have other limitations. So like gain bandwidth product. So generally for electron circuits, so gain and bandwidth product is constant. That means if you want more gain, you need to sacrifice the compromise for the bandwidth. If you want more bandwidth, so you need to compromise for the gain. So that is a problem. So in gain band product, it is a constant. But so there is a problem in this conventional tubes that we can overcome klystron tubes. Then power losses, we have the conductor loss, radiation loss, and dielectric losses. Okay. So then coming to the classification of the microwave tubes. Classification of microwave tubes. There are two types of microwave tubes, the linear beam tube and crossfield tube. So what are the main difference between these two means? So in linear beam tubes, so magnetic field is parallel to the electric field. So magnetic field is parallel to the electric field. So in crossfield tubes, that is M-type tube, so magnetic field and electric field are perpendicular to each other. So magnetic and magnetic field and the electric fields are perpendicular to each other. That is the major difference between linear tube and crossfield tube. So O-type tube and M-type tube is very important. Okay. So then we're coming to the O-type tubes. So this is the classification of O-type tubes. We have the two types we have here. So cavity type and slow wave structure. So these are the things we are using in the O-type microwave tubes. So in cavity resonators, so we have the multi-cavity, that means two cavity, three cavity, like that. So multi-cavity klystron, and that is an amplifier. And have the reflex klystron, it has a oscillator. It is a microwave generator. So coming to slow wave structure. So in slow wave structure, so we have the two things. So forward wave and backward wave. So forward wave and backward wave. So for forward wave, so we have the helix TWT, helix traveling wave tube, and coupled cavity traveling wave tube. So in backward wave, we have the two things are there. So back BWA, that means backward wave amplifier and backward wave oscillator. So backward wave amplifier and backward wave oscillator, right? So then coming to the klystron. So now what is the two cavity? So klystron has the two things we have here. So two cavity klystron and a reflex klystron. So two cavity klystron and reflex klystron. right? So now you can see the so two cavity klystron. So two cavity klystron. So you can see here. We'll draw and we'll share that for a minute. To note down these things. Okay, so this is very important. So two cavity klystron. Strong. That's it. Two cavity. So klystron. So the two things are there. So two cavity klystron and reflex klystron. So two cavity klystron is an amplifier. So reflex klystron is an oscillator. So now two cavity klystron. Yes.
Screen is not shared, sir.
Oh, sorry. It's visible now.
Yes, sir. It's okay. Visible.
Okay. So two cavity, so klystron. So we have the two things in our case. So two cavity klystron and reflex klystron. So two cavity klystron is an amplifier. So reflex klystron is an oscillator. So two cavity klystron means you have the so two cavities. So in the microwave tube have the two cavities. So I will draw the diagram. You also please draw. It's very important. So only two things we have in this case. So two cavity klystron and so reflex klystron. And one more cavity. So this is another cavity. All of you please draw this. So this is another cavity. So this is cavity one. This is called as the Buncher cavity. This is called as Buncher cavity. Called as Buncher cavity. This is called as Catcher cavity. Catcher cavity. So now, so there is a cathode here to generate electron beam. There is a cathode. So cathode here to generate electron beam. And so there is an anode. So this generates electron beam. There is an anode for beam formation. Anode. This is anode for beam formation. VG grid voltage you can take. So this is the V naught. So this is for input DC voltage. This is the V naught input DC voltage. Okay. So there is a RF input here. This is the RF input. RF input. So to amplify this RF input, this is the RF input we are giving at the so Buncher cavity, also called as the so input cavity. So Buncher cavity, so input cavity. So now this is electron beam. Okay. So now there is a collector here to collect this electron beam. Collector. This is a collector. Okay. So here. So this is our RF output. We will have the RF output. There is RF input, the input cavity. So here we are giving the RF input. So for amplifying purpose. So here the amplified output is collected at the output cavity. So this is the RF output. This is the RF output. So the distance between these two is the capital L. So L is the spacing between Buncher cavity and Thatcher cavity. This is the L is the so spacing between and right here. So one by one I will write. Then V naught. V naught is the DC voltage between cathode and puncture cavity. V naught is so DC voltage between puncture cavity and cathode. Okay. So then how the take the V1. V1 is amplitude of the RF signal. So amplitude of RF signal that we are giving there is the input for amplification purpose. So V1 is the so amplitude of the RF signal. So then we can take so there is the gap which in puncture cavity can take this is D. So D is the gap of the puncture cavity and cathode cavity. Both are same. This is the so gap in the puncture cavity and cathode cavity. D is the so gap of puncture or catcher cavity. So why is called a puncture cavity means so this puncture cavity helps to form the electron bunches. So the puncture cavity helps to form the electron bunches. So that's why it's called as a puncture cavity. So catcher cavity means so it will collect the electron bunches. To collect the electrons, collect the electron bunches, so it called as a catcher cavity, right? So you can write here, so this is a distance, so there is a time periods that also you can write. So suppose you travel like this, so here this is the gap D, this is the gap also D, so T naught, so T1, you can write T2, T3. So T naught is so time at which so electrons enter into the puncture cavity. So T1 is so time at which electrons leaves the puncture cavity. So T2 so time at which electrons enter into the so catcher cavity. And so T3 this is the time at which electrons leaves the catcher cavity. You can write easily. So T naught so see here so T naught T1. So T2, T3. So T0 is the so time at which electrons enter into the puncture cavity. So T1, time at which electron leaves the puncture cavity. So T2, time at which electrons enter into the catcher cavity. So T3, so time at which electron leaves the so catcher cavity. This is the time. Okay. This is the time. Okay. So these are the things. So we have the so two cavity klystron. So two cavities are there. One is the input cavity. You can write output cavity, or you can call as the input puncture cavity or catcher cavity. This also you can write output cavity. Output cavity. So puncture cavity. So why it's called puncture cavity means it will helps to form the electron bunches. So that I will explain how the electron bunches are formed. That we can explain so with the Applegate diagram. It's called the Applegate diagram. So but with the diagram I will explain how the electron bunches are formed. Okay. So why catcher cavity, why it's called catcher cavity means so it will catch the electron bunches, will collect the electron bunches. So the electron bunches will be collected by this catcher cavity. So then the electron beam is collected by the collector. So now see one by one here. So there is a cathode here. So cathode to heat this one, it will generate the electrons. It will generate the electron beam. So for beam formation, there is anode is there. So anode to form the electron beam. So electron beam for electron beam formation. You can write here. So cathode. So cathode. So this is heated to emit electrons. And we have the anode. So to form for formation of electron beam. Okay. So then we have the puncture cavity already told. So this is for to help us to form the electron bunches. So then catcher cavity. So help us to catch the electrons. bunches, electron bunches. So then, so there is a distance between these two is L. L is the so distance between buncher cavity and the catcher cavity. You can say spacing between buncher cavity and catcher cavity. You can write here. So L is the spacing between buncher cavity and catcher cavity between so buncher cavity and catcher cavity. So catcher cavity, right? So is it clear up to this point? So now we need to do how it will operate, the operation of the so two cavity klystron. So you need to remember two important things here. One is the velocity modulation. So another one is the current modulation. Okay, so now here, so see this one. So here the cathode will generate the electrons, this anode will form the electron beams. Now this electron wave so travel from this cathode to collector, so in this way. So now, so what are the input you want to amplify, whatever the so RF signal, so you want to amplify, so that I am giving at the buncher cavity. So now see here, so in this gap, so there is a interaction so between RF signal and our electron beam. So RF signal is like this. We have the so RF signal just like a this is a sinusoidal one. This is RF signal we have. This is my RF signal. This is RF signal. So RF signal is just like a AC signal. So now there is an electron beam here. So there is an interaction of this electron beam and RF signal. That means, so based on this alternate one, this AC signal, this RF signal will have the, so there is a, see, three points we can take here. One is the positive peak. So reference 01 and third one is the negative peak. So positive peak, so reference, that is zero voltage and is the negative peak. So you can take these three. If RF signal has a positive peak, so here there is a, so positive potential will develop in the gap of the buncher cavity. So please listen carefully. So here RF signal is just like an alternate signal. So have the three things you have to consider. One is the so positive peak of the RF signal, so negative peak of the RF signal, and there is a zero voltage. You can take so positive voltage, so negative voltage, and zero voltage. If RF signal having the positive amplitude, positive voltage, okay, so at that time there is a so positive potential will create here. So due to positive potential, so already we know, so the velocity of electron is equal to, so that you can cite V naught is equal to, so 2 into E by M V naught. So V naught is the so cathode voltage. V naught is the cathode voltage. So here, so in addition to this V naught, this voltage also added. So here, so I am writing for simple purpose. So now the V naught is equal to, that is V naught is the so velocity of electron. V naught is the velocity of electron. So 2 E by M, so we have the, so V naught, so plus, so gap voltage, I'm writing the VG here, or gap voltage or voltage at the buncher cavity. Again, some writing, some V1 I am writing. V1 is the amplitude now, so V1 is writing. So now see here, so when this V1 is added, if V1 is positive, so V1 is positive, now, so the velocity is directly proportional to this voltage. V1 is positive, what happened? So the velocity of electron is increased. So three cases you get to consider, please remember carefully. So whatever the signal we want to amplify, that RF signal, I am feeding at the input cavity. I am feeding at the buncher cavity. That means, so this RF, the amplitude of this RF signal will affect the velocity of the electron. So earlier, so electrons are travel from cathode to collector with the uniform velocity. All electrons are travel with uniform velocity from so cathode to anode. When I'm applying this RF signal, when I'm giving this RF signal to the input cavity, so the RF signal having the so positive peak, negative peak, and there is a zero, unchanged. Here the reference also there. So whenever the RF input is positive peak, whenever the RF input is positive peak. So in the gap of the Bancheri cavity, so there is a positive potential will created. Due to that potential, now see the this one. So due to this positive potential, so it will increase the velocity of the electron. It will increase the velocity of electron. That means, so whenever this positive voltage will coming at the gap of the Bancheri cavity, so now, so the velocity of electron is increased. Now the velocity of electron is increased. So now another thing, so for negative peak, so here, so it will create the, so retarded voltage, negative voltage at the gap of the Bancheri cavity. So now the electrons are interacted with negative one. So now the, so see here the relation. Now V naught is equal to, we can say V naught is equal to, so 2E by M V naught minus V1. Now, so the voltage will decrease. Now that means the electron also, velocity of electron also decrease. That means, so to negative peak, for the negative peak, so here, so due to that one, it will decrease the voltage in the gap. So the velocity of electron also decreases. The velocity of electron also decreases. That means for positive peak of the RF signal, due to positive peak RF signal, so the velocity of electron is increased. So due to negative peak of the RF signal, the velocity of electron is decreased. So third case, there is no zero reference. So zero voltage means, so there is no effect of the RF signal. So on the velocity of the electron beam. So here zero. So zero means this V1 is zero. So V1 is zero means, so the velocity of electron is V2 V1 by V0 only. There is no effect of this. So RF signal on the of the velocity of the electron. So at this point, so the electron travel with the, so unchanged velocity. That means previous velocity. So whatever the velocity of having the electron, it's travel with the same velocity. So now, so you can remember here, for positive peak of the RF signal, so electrons travel with the increased velocity. For negative peak of the RF signal, so electron travel with the, so decreasing velocity. So for reference, so electrons travel with the unchanged velocity. There is no change in the velocity. Now, so here you can observe here, so based on the amplitude of the RF signal, so the velocity of electron is varying. The velocity of electron is varying. Yes, for positive peak, it is increased velocity. For negative peak, so decreased velocity. So for reference one, so unchanged velocity. So what is meant by modulation? So what is meant by modulation? Modulation nothing but, so the characteristics of, so carrier signal is varied according to the modulating signal or according to the message signal, right? That is the modulation. So now, so I am assuming here, so my electron beam is carrier. So RF signal is the my modulating signal. So now, so the velocity of electron beam is varied according to the amplitude of the, so message signal. Yes, so the electron beam, the velocity of electron beam is varied according to the amplitude of the message signal. So that means, so for positive peak, increasing velocity. For negative peak, so decreased velocity. So for reference, unchanged velocity. That means, so here one of the character stick, that means, so the velocity of electron, so electron beam is the, so carrier in this case. So RF signal, we can carry the modulating signal. Now, so the characteristics of, so electron beam is varied according to the amplitude of the message. So which characteristics is varying here? The velocity. So velocity of electron is varied according to the amplitude of the message signal. Now it's called as a velocity modulation. Like our amplitude modulation, a frequency modulation. What is amplitude modulation? Amplitude of carrier is varied according to the amplitude of the message signal. What is the frequency modulation? So frequency of the carrier signal is varied according to the amplitude of the message signal. What is the phase modulation? So phase of the carrier is varied according to the amplitude of the message signal. Okay. What is the PPM? So pulse position modulation. So the position of the pulse is varied according to the amplitude of the message signal. In the same manner, so the velocity of the carrier. What is the carrier here? The carrier is the electron beam in this case, right? So the amplitude of the carrier is varied according to the, the velocity of the carrier. Velocity of the carrier is varied according to the amplitude of the message signal. So we can say it is a velocity modulation. It is a very, very important one. So So which modulation takes place in the klystrons? So which modulation? So they will give, so velocity modulation, current, sorry, amplitude modulation, frequency modulation, like that. So which modulation is a new term? So velocity modulation. So what is the velocity modulation? So here the carrier is electron beam. So RF signal is our message signal, our modulating signal. So one of the characteristics of the carrier, that means, so the velocity, which characteristic here? The velocity of the carrier is varied according to the amplitude of the message signal. So that is called as the, so velocity modulation. So if velocity modulation takes place, so now, so is it clear up to this point? So now, so there is a velocity modulation. So it will take place. So in the Bunsen cavity, that means the electron leaves after the Bunsen cavity with, so different velocities. One is the increasing velocity, so decreasing velocity. One is the unchanged velocity, right? So due to that one, so now I'll explain. So based on the Rapel gate diagram, how the electron bunches are formed, how the, so electron bunches are formed in the, so in the drift space. So this is called as the, so drift space. So this is called as the, so this space is called as the drift space. Is it clear? What is meant by velocity modulation? Anyone, please?
Yes, sir.
Right? Yes, sir. Okay. So I'm explaining once again, please. So after this one, later I will explain the what is meant by Rapel gate diagram. That is more than sufficient. So now have the two cavity klystron. Why it's called two cavity means you have the two cavities. So input cavity, output cavity. Input cavity is also called as Bunsen cavity. Why it's called Bunsen cavity? It helps us to, so form the electron bunches. So catcher cavity, it will catch the electron bunches. So whatever the input you want to amplify, that I'm applying at the input cavity, that is RF input, I'm feeding here. So this is RF output I'm collecting at the catcher cavity. There is a cathode, so it is to emit the electrons. So there is an anode here. So to form the electron beam, So now my electron beam is traveled from cathode to collector, So the distance between these two is the L, that is spacing between Bunsen cavity and catcher cavity. So then we can say there is a DC voltage V naught, and V1 is the amplitude of the RF signal. So the small d is the gap between in Bunsen cavity and gap in the catcher cavity. We have the T naught, T1, T2, T3. T0 is the time at which electron beam enter into the Bunsen cavity. So T1, time at which electron leaves the Bunsen cavity. So T2, so time at which electron beam enter into the catcher cavity. T3, time at which electron beam leaves the catcher cavity. So in general thing, you know, the velocity of electron, this is the, so velocity of electron. So V naught is equal to, so 2EM by, so capital V naught, F into the DC voltage. This is the, so capital V naught is the, this is the DC voltage, this is the DC voltage. Okay. So due to this RF signal, so RF signal is just like a sinusoidal one. So there is a potential variation. So potential variation at the gap of the Bunsen cavity. That means, so for positive peak, you have the positive potential to develop. For negative peak, there is a retarded potential. That means, so this will affect the velocity of electron. That means, so this voltage will add it to the V naught. If it is positive, it will add it. So here velocity of electron and V naught both are directly proportional. That means if you increase the velocity, the potential, that means voltage, so velocity of electron also increases. If you decrease the voltage, so velocity of electron also decreases. Okay. So now we have the three cases here. For positive peak of the RF signal, so here there is a positive potential will develop. So that means it will increase the voltage. So due to the voltage, so the electron velocity of electron also increased. For positive peak, so it will increase. So for negative peak, it will, there is a retarded potential. So the net voltage will decrease. So that means the velocity of electron also decrease. So for reference, that means there is zero voltage here. So zero voltage means, so no effect after this one on the velocity of the electron. That means, so due to RF signal, so after Bunsen cavity, the electron travel with the, so three velocities. It means One is increasing velocity, so decreasing velocity and unchanged velocity. That means earlier velocity only. That means here, so the velocity of electron is varied according to the amplitude of the message signal. So it is called as a velocity modulation. So what is meant by modulation? So modulation nothing but, so the characteristics of the carrier is varied according to the amplitude of the message signal. So based on the characteristics, we can say amplitude modulation or frequency modulation like this. Frequency of carrier is varied, frequency modulation. Amplitude of carrier is varied, amplitude modulation. Like that. So in this case, the velocity of electron beam, here carrier is the electron beam. So velocity of electron beam is varied according to the amplitude of the message signal. We have the velocity modulation. Okay. That means after this Bunsen cavity, so in drift phase, electron travel with the, so three different velocities. So one is the, so unchanged velocity, so increasing velocity and decreasing velocity. So now we'll see the aggregate diagram. So how the electron bunches are formed in the drift space. Okay. So that we will see. So now I think, is it clear up to this point? So now we'll go for the next one. So aggregate diagram. So you need to explain the operation of two cavity klystron